Cubone is hands down one of the best designed Pokemon of Generation 1. It's cute, it's cool, and above all, it's mysterious. That skull helmet that hides its true face is probably the main reason that it's remained so popular through all these years. Well, that and the tragic backstory. That skull helmet has been at the center of Pokemon theories for over 2 decades, and it's at the center of this video. This is Theory and Design Episode 2, and today we're going to try to figure out what exactly is Cubone. Hang on, the rest of this video was all recorded a couple days ago, but it's Monday now, and about 12 hours ago there was a huge new development on this topic. You've probably heard about it by now, and don't worry, I will address it. But I actually think the arguments I made in the video hold up, so I'm going to play the rest of the video as it was originally recorded, and I'll talk about the new information at the very end. The idea that Cubone is an orphaned baby Kangaskhan is one of the oldest, most persistent, and most popular Pokemon theories out there. We've been speculating on what Cubone might be since Red and Blue, and Kangaskhan was the most natural fit. And unlike some other old theories, the volume of evidence here just keeps growing. But in the last few years, there's been a competing theory that has gained quite a bit of attention and support. I believe it was started by Loxton and Proto Mario, and it posits that Cubone is actually an orphaned baby Charmander instead, whose tail flame was never ignited. Now, my intention with this miniseries is to focus on design evidence to strengthen or weaken theories, but when it comes to Cubone, there is so much other evidence, there's no way I could cover it without touching on all of those non-design points. The main evidence for Kangaskhan is either very old or very new. On the very old side, we have their shared parent themes, the parent Pokemon and the Pokemon that lost a parent, their Australian references, the kangaroo and the boomerang. And most importantly, in Red and Blue, we had the glitch Pokemon M that could evolve into Kangaskhan, suggesting that Kangaskhan originally had a pre-evolved form. On the very new side, we have Kangaskhan appearing as an SOS ally to Cubone in the Alola games. Although it's iffy to take this at face value because it's so new, it could be an Easter egg. There's also some minor evidence, like how they're frequently found in the same areas and how they're both in the Monster Egg group. But of course, the main reason this connection was made is that Cubone and baby Kangaskhan kinda look alike. They have very similar proportions with a big head, stubby limbs, and a short tail. They also have spikes on their backs, and Marowak and Kangaskhan have a spike on pretty much the same spot on their tails. Interestingly, Marowak's official art only ever shows it with that one tail spike, but its original back sprite actually shows it with very prominent spikes along its spine. But Kangaskhan also has armor plates, which Cubone and Marowak never get. Baby Kangaskhan doesn't have the armor plates either, but during Mega Evolution, it does get them. The baby also has a sort of purple-gray skin, which Cubone doesn't have. But here's another instance where we should really be looking at the oldest art we can find. And in the official art from Red and Green, the purple tinge is almost gone. Now, this still doesn't look like Cubone's skin color, even in the art from Red and Green, but it does match pretty closely this Cubone art, drawn by Ken Sugimori, for the old Pocket Monsters trading cards. And other Cubone art does match the skin color of adult Kangaskhan pretty well. I also want to point out Cubone and Kangaskhan's eyes. They don't match, but Baby Kanga and Mama Kanga don't match either. Baby has solid black eyes, while Mama has white sclera and small red irises. And if you think about how a growing Kangaskhan might transition between them, you get Cubone's eyes, with the black irises of the baby and the white sclera of the adult. So maybe Cubone isn't a baby Kangaskhan, but a slightly more developed juvenile. But the one really big piece of evidence against the Kangaskhan theory is actually Cubone's skull helmet itself. This really doesn't look much like what you'd expect a Kangaskhan skull to look like. It's too long and narrow, and Kangaskhan doesn't have those horns. It does have something that looks like ears, although I'm not totally convinced that's what they were always meant to be, but even if they were horns, they don't have that round shape. And this is where the Charmander theory comes in, proposing that the skull actually belongs to a Charizard, and that Cubone is basically a malformed Charmander. And yeah, this is basically what I'd expect a Charizard skull to look like. Charmander doesn't have any plate armor, so that works. And while Charmander doesn't get any spikes on its back nowadays, it did originally have one, so that's also fitting. And the overall anatomy, well, It is pretty close, but Charmander is much more elongated than our stocky Cubone. Charmander is taller, it has longer limbs, and a much longer tail. Charizard's fire type does relate to Alolan Marowak, where the spirit of the mother is supposed to be imbued in the bones, but I find this evidence kind of weak because it seems more metaphorical. And as long as we're mentioning minor evidence, remember that Charmander, while it is in the Monster Egg Group along with Cubone, is also in the Dragon Egg Group, which Cubone is not in. If they were supposed to be the same thing, that wouldn't make much sense. So, to make a decision about whether we think Cubone is a Charmander or a Kangaskhan, either way we have to give up something. If it's a Charmander, we have to ignore a whole bunch of hints towards Kangaskhan, whereas if it's a Kangaskhan, we have to ignore a really big flaw in the theory, which is the shape of the skull. So you might think that it comes down to preference, but I actually have one more piece of evidence to share. I didn't want to bring it up earlier because I find it pretty conclusive, so it would render the whole discussion moot. Like last time, let's check the index order, which is basically the order that the Pokemon were added into the game. Well, the index order tells us that Cubone and Kangaskhan were both in the first batch of Pokemon designed. Marowak wasn't added until way later, and the entire Charmander family was added at once, almost at the end of development. Now, evolution wasn't a thing back when Cubone and Kangaskhan were added, so we can't necessarily say that they were designed to be related. But Cubone existed literal years before the Charmander line did, which to me just completely eliminates Charmander from the competition. Cubone could have been redesigned at some point with Charizard Skull specifically in mind, but we don't have any evidence of that. As far as I'm concerned, Cubone is a Kangaskhan. But even still, neither theory is perfect. Besides what we already talked about, both theories face issues with the gender ratio, since Cubone and Marowak are 50-50 male and female, while Kangaskhan are 100% female, and Charmander are 87.5% male, so neither fits. And also, neither really explains why, in terms of the game mechanics, Cubone are born with a skull helmet, and you can have Cubone that aren't orphans. This is actually a flaw with the whole approach to this theory. When we ask, what is Cubone? We neglect to distinguish between the two parts of this issue. We should really be asking, what was Cubone originally designed as, and what is Cubone presented as in the games? Those are very different questions, and I haven't seen any theories that can satisfactorily answer both and equally account for game mechanics, design, and lore. Most of this video, we've been looking at what was Cubone originally designed as. But to be real purists about it, we have to ignore everything that wasn't around back then. That means we ignore Mega Kangaskhan, we ignore SOS battles, even gender ratios and egg groups are iffy since they're from Gen 2. So we lose a lot of the circumstantial evidence in favor of the Kangaskhan theory, but we actually get to keep all of the solid design evidence, which is why I stand by this theory even though the shape of the skull is still problematic. Now, if we want to answer what is Cubone presented as, not what did the developers originally have in mind for it, but actually taking all the games at face value, we don't really need to care about what the old art looked like. And we actually need to ignore one of the most important aspects of Cubone lore. Here's the thing. If Cubone never takes off its helmet and no one has seen its true face, like the Pokédex has been claiming since Red and Blue, how could anyone know that the skull is from its dead mother like the Pokédex has been claiming since Yellow? If you haven't seen it without the helmet, then you didn't see it put the helmet on, which means you can't know for sure where it got the helmet from. The Pokédex contradicts itself. What else is new? So this warrants more research, but to me it seems possible, not to say likely, that the whole dead mother thing is just a legend. Maybe Cubone and Marowak just have really thick bone plating on their heads like a Pachycephalosaurus Plus. Maybe they roam alone and their cries sound really sad, so when people saw this they assumed or projected the loss of a parent. I think this fits in terms of all of the game mechanics, the breeding, the gender ratio, even the SOS battle, since I can picture Kangaskhan, the protective parent Pokemon, coming to the aid of a young Pokemon in trouble. Maybe Cubone even sounds like a Kangaskhan baby. But again, this warrants a deeper look. Hi, Monday Libras here. So, that new information. In case you haven't heard, this morning the Helix Chamber released a ton of beta materials from the development of the original Red and Green, which they received from an anonymous donor a few months ago. That included unused trainers, maps, and most importantly, Pokemon. You'll have to check their website and Twitter for the full breakdown, links in the doobly-doo. But the unused Pokemon included ones that we'd seen in the Tojiri manga and in the Space Worlds 1997 demo, as well as Pokemon that we knew about but hadn't seen, and Pokemon that we had no idea about. The one that matters to this video was an evolution to Marowak, but the problem is that the anonymous donor only gave them Pokemon back sprites, not front sprites. So even though these do give us an idea of what these Pokemon looked like, they're still very low resolution and incomplete. Nevertheless, it's undeniable that this, which is confirmed to be a Marowak evolution, looks a lot like a large Marowak holding a baby Cubone in its arms, skull helmet and all. Many people have assumed this points to or even confirms Cubone's relationship with Kangaskhan. I think it's too little to go on, but I admit that with the parent and baby thing, the connection is hard not to make. But we really don't have enough detail here to draw any conclusions. This looks a lot more like the Marowak sprite than the Kangaskhan sprite. Marowak's evolution comes right after Marowak itself in the index order, meaning they were probably added at the same time. And since, as far as we can tell, Marowak's evolution and Kangaskhan existed at the same time, this gives me an idea of what the thinking might have been. Maybe Cubone really was originally supposed to be an orphan baby Kangaskhan. But when they made evolutions, they gave Cubone its own evolutionary line. It would eventually grow to be something that looks like a Kangaskhan, but it was actually its own separate species now, able to breed more little Cubones. That's purely speculation, but it does fit with the idea of Cubone being its own independent species in how the games present it, so I guess that's my headcanon. Whew, that was a long one, but I hope that you enjoyed this video and this miniseries as a whole. If you haven't seen it, check out last week's video on swapped designs. And keep sending me theories to look at. You did already give me some good ideas in last week's video, but keep them coming. Of course, if you did enjoy this video, please let me know by clicking the like button, leaving a comment, and sharing this video with a friend. You'll be helping me tremendously. And if you're new here, subscribe for more Pokemon content. I'm Umbreon Libris, and I'll see you in the next chapter.